my family and came from back in Turkey and from Kosovo and other city. Is originally, yes, we came over there.
Great. I'm also a second generation immigrant, but to Australia.
Yes, sir. Australia also, Christian Vieri, Australia, you know?
Exactly. Sometimes I see him in Milano walking around in Brera area, up and down Corso Garibaldi.
Yes, yes. And he's living and still in Milano. I know him, yeah. He was a great player, but he was a funny guy. And so comfortable and bear speaking everybody. I like him. Yeah.
This probably nice. Comes from his upbringing in Australia. We call this word a larrikin in Australia, when you can use sarcasm and joking around and make everyone feel at home. And that's what it sounds like he is. Even when I hear an interview this year, when you can hear him, he just sounds so comfortable and he'd be a great guy to have a beer with. Yes. So hopefully you can get back to Milano and have an Astrazzurro with Christian.
Yes. Say this, but let me put it. He has a great sense of humor too. He has a very witty sense of humor.
I can see by his smile. Yeah. You can read it in someone's face when they've got a really good sense of humor. I think maybe I need to test you on some Italian, but we'll get to that. I'll get you on some Italian. Don't worry about that. So going back to that Champions League game against Barcelona, that was the year that Milan lost to Ajax in the final 1-0. So your first years in the Champions League resulted in famous victories against Manchester United and Barcelona, who were amongst the very, very best teams outside of Serie A. You came from a side that won 4 in a row with Galatasaray later on in the 90s. The three Romanians, as we've spoken about, Popescu, Filipescu and Hagi, plus Claudio Taffarel, the great Brazilian goalkeeper, Emre Belözoğlu and Okan Buruk in that team, where you finished equal with Juventus in the Champions League on 8 points, I remember. Yes. But you failed to go through in 1998-99 and you scored 6 goals throughout the qualifiers in the group, drawing with Juventus twice, I think, under Fatih Terim.
Yes.
And then you scored an equalizer for 1-1 at Delle Alpi against Marcello Lippi's team, featuring Pippo Inzaghi, Del Piero, David Zidane. And it was the Inzaghi overhead kick.
That was a nice score, yeah.
Beautiful goal. And then you got in behind the defense to control and finish from 6 yards past Peruzzi.
It was a great, great score, yeah.
Do you have those memories still?
Yes. You remember better than me. You are great. And
I do my research. Plus, how can I not research when someone like you comes on? So second by second, do you still remember how you did it?
Yes. If you say any goal, I remember everything, because before the goal and dressing room and last pass from who, and I remember everything. And when we played the Juventus and against Juve, and in Delle Alpi, and you get remember in score, and Hasan Şaş, there was a good player, and from the left side, and he got the ball and inside, after I run and inside and pass behind the defense, and I got the ball, and first control was great, and second touch, and also great, and I remember the score. Sometimes I'm watching and from YouTube and my scores, but now I have and 3 kids. We are watching together and I'm showing my goals and all goals. And my son is sometimes, wow, dad, did you make it? And there are a lot of score. And you played Juventus against Juve, against Milan, against Manchester United. You had a lot of score. But it's technology and better and for my family and for memorize is most important. I return and my back, and together with my family, I remember everything.
Great. And it's much easier to look at the internet instead of carrying video cassettes from the 1990s and 2000s. As they say in Turkish, çok güzel.
Çok güzel.
But while
playing and difficult, while playing and maybe 20 years ago and before the game, after the game, and After the game, you are happy. But before the game, you were a lot of and stressful, you know, and there was a lot of big game. But a nice story, maybe this time we are going to make a movie.
Okay.
And we are speaking any and journalist, any scenarist, any writer, and we are speaking about a movie. And I have a lot of story, but maybe only one movie and 1.5 hours. Not enough for me.
You need a series.
I told them sometimes in for documentary better for me and not movie. But they told me, and we are going to do and maybe movie and flashback, you know, and they are preparing a different and story.
Well, directors, producers, you've heard this now from the horse's mouth, and you know where to go if you want the next big series, because this is about the biggest player ever in Turkish history, European history, scored the world's fastest goal at the FIFA World Cup. So, and you've had a very interesting life since then. Yeah. So talking about those memories, your children must be very impressed with all the accomplishments of your career. So we'll go back to just quickly to Galatasaray in the late 90s. It was in that game where you beat Peruzzi, Inzaghi's overhead free kick. That's what got you the 1-1 draw at the Dele Alpi. On the final match day, Juventus beat Rosenborg and Gala lost to Athletic Bilbao, which brought Juventus level on 8 points. Yes. And ultimately, they went through with a better goal difference. So Juventus fans will be happy, but disappointing for you. But the next year, in the 1999-2000 season, after scoring 4 goals in the Champions League, your Gala side defeated the AC Milan of George Weah and Andriy Shevchenko on the final match day of the group stage, a come-from-behind victory with yourself and Umit Davala clinching victory and sneaking into third place and thus qualifying for the UEFA Cup, the Europa League, as we know it now, the knockout phase. You scored a diving header in the 87th minute to equalize for 2-2. You won the penalty against Bruno Ngoti, in which Umut Davala scored in added time in stoppages to win 3-2 and Galatasaray go through. So from there, you scored at the Renato Dall'Ara against Beppe Signori's Bologna in the third round of the UEFA Cup. Gala wins that 3-2 on aggregate. And this is an ascent. I'm getting somewhere, people. A big vertical leap, your header. And I understand you were carrying an injury at that time, a leg injury, and you had to jump and just wait for the ball to come to you, but an intelligent headed goal.
Yeah. And ball against Bologna, is right?
Yeah, against Bologna.
It was in 1-1 and finished Signori and me in 1-1 and second game, a game, and we won in 2-1. And Ümit Davala and Hasan Şaş scoring and together, and we won 2-1. And was difficult game. They missing any one position. It was in crazy. If they had a score and maybe eliminated in Galatasaray, but in after the Bologna game, and there was a lot of and great game and different.
Oh yeah,
and our team, yes.
The Borussia Dortmund game, you and George Haji at the Westfalenstadion.
Yes.
In the fourth round. Then 2 more goals against Mallorca in the quarterfinal.
Also, yes.
Then 2 more for you against Leeds United in the semifinal.
Yes.
And that was your first English scalp of this trophy. Then the big one, the victory over Arsenal at Parken Stadium in Copenhagen, where you converted your penalty to defeat Arsenal 4-1. There was another Suker in this game, a different pronounced Davo Suker, the Croatian, and Patrick Vieira. They both missed their penalties in the shootout. And Galatasaray, they clinch the first historic piece of European silverware.
Yeah.
In fact, no other Turkish club has made it past the semifinals of the UEFA Cup before. Just since then, Fenerbahce in 2013. And before this was, am I pronouncing this right, Göztepe, in 1969, they made it to the quarterfinals, I think. So is this your greatest club achievement?
Yes, my success and UEFA champion and third place in World Cup, and is best.
Awesome. And I mean, many, many players have never had the success that you've had. You went from Galatasaray to Inter following all this success, including winning the treble at Gala, the three trophies in the one season. You moved to Serie A again, signing for Moratti's Inter Milan in the year 2000. Inter was coached by Marcello Lippi, as you said.
Yes.
Until October, he was sacked. And then it was Marco Tardelli who came in. So a very chaotic time for Inter, seeing as though Ronaldo was injured for so long with his knee injury. Christian Vieri was also injured, recovering.
Yes, a lot of times injured, Vieri.
What was it like for you to be considered one of the best strikers in the world, recruited to the club with the highest aspirations in the world? Because Inter Milan in this moment only wanted to win. It was not building. It was getting the best players ready to put on the field.
So Lippi was the coach at that time.
Çok büyük bir koçtu.
So he was one of the greatest at that time.
Beni Juventus'u çalıştırdığı dönemlerden bildiği için beni o istedi.
Since he had known me from the Juventus times, he actually wanted to recruit me.
Geldikten sonra tabii onun da söylediği gibi almayı, çok önemli oyuncuları almayı beceren bir takımdı. Parası çok vardı Moratti'nin.
As you mentioned, Moratti had a lot of money and then as a team, they were recruiting all these, you know, greatest players around the world.
Yani içlerinde en az alan bendim yani.
So I was probably getting the least payment between those, you know, players.
Yani UEFA şampiyonu ve o kupayı alırken çok gol atmış bir oyuncu olarak çok güçlü geldim aslında.
Even though, you know, I had a great background with all the goals that I scored in my past teams and the World Cup third place.
Çok büyülü, çok önemli bir ortamdı. Yani çok önemli oyuncular vardı.
You know, it was a fantastic, magnificent place, the you know, environment there.
Dünyanın en iyi oyuncusu club. Ronaldo oradaydı. Yani çok başarılı bir şey ama sakattı.
Ronaldo, you know, one of the best players was there during that time, even though, you know, he was injured.
Also Vieri and injured.
Vieri also, we all know, he was one of the greatest, he was injured.
Moratti'nin özel ilgisi, çok sevdiği bir oyuncu Rekova vardı.
One of Moratti's favorite, again, another great striker, Rekova was there.
Also, and Blan, Laurent Blan, were France players, and there was an like this, and there was a lot of and Jugovic and Baggio and. Benim için çok büyülü bir ortamdı, güzel bir ortamdı.
Yeah, it was just a you know beautiful environment. I just loved it.
Ama sanıyorum Lippi'nin Juventus'ta gördüğü havayı Inter Milan'da göremedi Lippi. Çünkü o anları çok iyi hatırlıyorum. Yani birçok yıldız oyuncuya oyuncunun performansından çok memnun değildi. Hani bir takım olmayı beceremiyorduk. Andreas Pirlo, there was a Pirlo also and a roommate, my roommate in you know Appiano Gentile I have one roommate and Andreas Pirlo. He's in still in working in Turkey now.
Lippi kind of tried to, you know, have the same success that he had in Juventus when he came to Inter Milan. But even though we had great players, I think he couldn't create that team bonding or, you know, making sure that all those players play together. So he wasn't successful in that. And then after a game or so, I guess he left the team.
So Lippi struggled to create the same environment that he had at Juventus. And, you know, despite being surrounded by huge superstars, he just couldn't get the team to gel the way in which it should have, considering the big names that they had. Juventus had a college team mentality and Inter just couldn't replicate this. And Lippi ended up leaving in October, but he signed you after some wonderful seasons in Istanbul, because you scored 46 goals, 34 goals, 27 goals, 25 goals.